Welcome to UO Today. I'm Paul Pepis, Director of the Oregon Humanities Center. My guest today is Christoph Lindner, Professor and Dean of the UO School of Architecture and Allied Arts. Prior to coming to the UO in 2016, Lindner was Professor of Media and Culture at the University of Amsterdam. His recent book publications include the monograph Imagining New York City, as well as the edited volumes Global Garbage, Cities Interrupted, Visual Culture and Urban Space, Inert Cities, Globalization, Mobility, and Suspension in Visual Culture, and Paris, Amsterdam, Underground. Thanks, Christoph, for coming on the show.
My pleasure.
So you have an unusual international background. Would you tell us about your background and how your career trajectory developed?
I guess I would describe an academic career a little bit like being in the Army, particularly when you come out of graduate school, in the sense that you go where you're posted and you don't ask questions. And I think for me, that is very much how my academic career started. I was very fortunate to get a tenure track position just before finishing my PhD, and I obviously jumped on it, embraced it, and ran with it. Mm-hmm. But it was not in the area in which I was interested in researching coming out of my PhD. Hmm. So I think, like a lot of people, by the time they finish their graduate work, they're ready to move on to something else. In my case, my graduate work focused on Victorian literature, so that's what I was trained in. But I knew by then that I wanted to move away from Victorian literature and more towards, I guess, something we could call urban studies. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of the trajectory of my career, both in terms of the kinds of institutions, the different countries where I've lived and worked, but also the kinds of books that I've written and researched over the years, all of that reflects an effort to pursue my academic interests wherever they were leading. And what I find particularly exciting about the work that I do, and I think this really is something that so many scholars enjoy, is that a tremendous privilege of what we do in a university is we can follow our ideas where they take us. There is never an excuse to be bored as a professor. And that's what I really try to embrace. But what it does mean is that things are a little bit unpredictable. I'm not sure what book will follow the one I'm working on now and so forth down the line. But I think if you look now at the trajectory of my career, I think it is clear that I've sort of settled in the area of kind of interdisciplinary urban studies with a focus on culture, that I'm really interested in things like globalization and the arts in urban environments, and that there are lots of ways of approaching this that both draw on my background in literary and cultural theory, but also connect to areas where I've been developing expertise over the years, things like architecture, urban design, landscape, geography, media studies, these kinds of things.
So what led to your interest in cities and urbanism in particular? I mean, that seems to be the sort of core center of what you're doing.
Again, it goes back to graduate school. So like a lot of people, when I first started teaching, I had very little say as a graduate student in terms of what I would teach. I was assigned things that I knew very little about that I had to get up to speed in, and as I got to know them, I found I also wasn't very interested in them. I won't mention what they are, I don't want to offend anybody. But alongside that, at the university where I was based, and this was the University of Edinburgh in Scotland, which is where I did my PhD, as well as my master's, like a lot of grad students, I needed to make a bit of extra money, and the continuing education program, which brought in adult and continuing students back into the university to study, was one of the few places on campus where it was possible to do more teaching, but also to propose topics for teaching. And in that context, there was a very practical thing, which was if you didn't recruit enough students, your course didn't run. And so I had to come up with courses that I thought would draw in the students. And that's when I started proposing courses on cities and film noir. And this both recruited the students I needed to run the courses, but through that, as I was reading and preparing for the teaching, realizing that there were lots of connections between that area of, say, filmic urban studies mm-hmm. and modern and contemporary literature, where I was sort of focused. And that, for me, was the bridge. And then I've just kept going ever since.
Okay, so given that, let's talk about your most recent monograph, Imagining New York City, Literature, Urbanism, and the Visual Arts, 1890 to 1940. So tell us what that book is about, mm-hmm. sort of what the argument of the book is, and why literature, urbanism, and the visual arts? Why that range of material?
I guess the first thing I would say about that book is it's a labor of love. It's a book I wrote because at a certain point, I fell in love with the city of New York. I might still be in love with the city of New York, but
yes,
maybe
your
not.
Intro makes that clear. You had planned to write a different book, right?
That's right. So I got the funding and the sabbatical to go to New York to write a book called Urban Narrative: From Dickens to Film Noir. And as I was spending time sort of immersed in the archives of the New York Public Library and the New York Historical Society, and also, you know, surfacing for lunch in the evenings, and I realized that the book I really wanted to write was about New York City. And so I kind of organized the book and wrote it from the premise of trying to think through how New York has this tendency to hijack the cultural imagination. I'm not the first person to be seduced by New York, both the dream but also the broken promises that the city offers. So that's what I wanted to explore. But I was interested in focusing on the historical period between 1890 and 1940, because that's really when the iconic modern metropolis, as we know it today, really started to take form. And this is architecturally, this is also in terms of how the city was being planned and developed and spatially organized. It was also in terms of the arts, so the kinds of writing and music scenes and painting and art scenes and photography that were emerging in the city, but also in terms of kind of civic public conversations about what is a modern city, how should it work, what kinds of values should it have. And New York didn't solve a lot of those questions, and they remain unresolved there as in other cities worldwide. But it's a place where a lot of those important conversations were happening. So for me, looking at the city in that modernist moment was really important to understand the global city that exists today. And I think so much of what we identify with contemporary New York either has its roots in or is in some way influenced by the earlier city of the turn of the 20th century.
So tell us how the book is organized, because it's very interesting the way it's structured.
So it's structured in two main parts. There's a part focusing on skylines, which is vertical iterations of the city, so looking at the rise of the skyscraper, but also how that produced new interest in panoramas and landscapes. And the second part of the book is organized around sidewalks, so the more the horizontal dimensions of the city. Now, there's a long history of thinking about cities in terms of these two axes, the horizontal and the vertical. And in the book, I kind of resurrect that dichotomy, but also try to problematize it. Mm-hmm. And the book actually ends with a whole extended section on subways and underground New York, mm-hmm. and the ways in which, literally, physically, the New York subway, as it kind of snakes around the city, kind of rejects the linearity of the grid, problematizes the hypervisibility of the vertical, and complicates our understanding of where a street begins and ends, these kinds of concerns. But the organization of the book was also partly a reflection of the material that I was working with. Mm-hmm. So even though I tried to problematize this simple relationship between vertical and horizontal, I noticed that so many writers, artists, architects, planners, designers were working with along those axes. Mm-hmm. And so it's partly a way of registering what the material I was studying was doing.
And predictably, given the scope of your project, the archive of materials, I mean, you've just given us a sense. It's a very broad archive. It's literary, it's visual art, it's photography, it's urban planning. It's a huge range of materials.
Mm-hmm.
How long did it take you to write that thing?
About a decade. And along the way, there were three transatlantic moves. Various children were born. Various admin roles and chairing and director roles were done. So it was a long process, but I'm glad it was, because this was a book that was not written to satisfy, say, research requirements for promotion, mm-hmm. or to satisfy the terms of a grant or sabbatical. This was mm-hmm. a book that was written because I felt I had something to say about New York and I wanted to think it through. I think it's also worth mentioning as a sort of footnote that it's a book that was started just before I left the UK. And the writing of this book is one of the things that influenced me to move away from the UK, because this was a time where in the UK, through something which at the time was called the Research Assessment Exercise, and it's now called the Research Excellence Framework, was putting a lot of pressure on academics to publish very, very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And I was right at the beginning of the book, and I was in a situation where I looked like I was going to get a grant and a sabbatical to finish the book within a year. And I thought I could do that, but it wouldn't be very good.
And it wouldn't be the book you wrote.
And no, and it kind of connects to where my scholarship is going at the moment, which is currently the book I'm writing is about slowness. It's about creative slow practices in an era of speed. Mm-hmm. So we live in an accelerating world. So what does it mean? And what are the values of sometimes being slow? And I think there's a case to be made, and I'm not the only one making it sometimes, for slow scholarship, for the value of thinking ideas through, of letting them sit and simmer, distilling them, so that what you actually share and disseminate to the world is something that you think has value, that you think makes a contribution to knowledge, rather than a line on your CV.
Excellent. More power to you in that effort. Tell us about the one of the theoretical concepts at the core of this book, but also of your work in general, is this the urban imaginary. What is the urban imaginary?
It's a great question to ask, because one of the books I'm working on at the moment is a companion book for Routledge, the companion to urban imaginary. So the idea is that lots of people in different fields across the humanities, social science, and design fields are working with this concept of urban imaginary. And this collection that I'm putting together would kind of bring together the best of writing from across those fields and help kind of unpack, explain this concept, but also demonstrate how it can be mobilized in scholarship. But very, very briefly, the concept of urban imaginary is one that comes out of the spatial turn in critical theory in, say, the 60s and 70s. And you can trace it back in particular to the work of thinkers like Michel Foucault, Henri Lefebvre, working in Paris on the spatiality of urban life, as well as American thinkers like Kevin Lynch. And what all of their work, well, the parts of their work that deals with urban imaginary have in common is to say that how you think about cities, or space, even more specifically, the interpretive frameworks through which you interpret and understand space have a very powerful influence, not just on your sense of a place, of a space, but also how you act in it, how you organize it, how you police it, how you build it, how you knock it down. And a lot of work over the last 20 years that is concerned with urban imaginaries is making an argument that it is a critical component to how cities work, that understanding urban imaginaries is just as important as understanding the brick and mortar city in which we kind of live.
Fascinating. So you spoke about how we build it up, how we destroy it. So another of your co-edited volumes is just about to be published. It's like being published in 2 weeks or 3 weeks. It's called Deconstructing the High Line, Post-Industrial Urbanism and the Rise of the Elevated Park. Now, this is a very interesting example of how things are fall out of use in cities and also are resurrected in cities. What is the High Line, first of all? And why is it important for people that study urbanism to think about the High Line?
So the High Line was originally an elevated freight railway that ran through the west side of Manhattan in New York City. It was built in the 1930s. It fell out of use in the 1980s, and it sat abandoned for a couple decades. And then in the late 90s, early 2000s, some local residents on the west side of Manhattan mobilized community interest and community organization to rehabilitate the space. And out of this effort, with a lot of backing from the city and various investors, came the High Line Elevated Park. So what that park does is it takes the abandoned post-industrial transport infrastructure and transforms it into a highly manicured, beautifully landscaped, artistically curated, architecturally pampered park. And it has been absolutely phenomenal in the interest that it has created. First with residents, then with visitors and businesses. And it's been something of a phenomenon in New York City, and it's been hugely successful in terms of iconicity, being recognizable, attracting up to 4.5 million visitors or more annually, as well as economically revitalizing the neighborhood that surrounds it. The reason I think it matters, well, there are a number of reasons, but the two main ones, and these are what we explore in this book, Deconstructing the High Line, is that, first of all, the High Line has had something of a gentrifying effect on the city. So yes, it has rehabilitated or helped redevelop the neighborhoods around it, but for whom and to whose benefit? And there's a lot of data now, and there's a lot of kind of experience now that is emerging, which demonstrates that the High Line has displaced a lot of local residents, and that what it's creating is not just gentrification, but whatever comes next. Some people call it super gentrification or hyper gentrification, that even the gentrifiers can't afford to stay. So it's the super rich displacing the quite rich, displacing the kind of middle class and poor. Mm-hmm. That's one part of the High Line. And so it raises questions, is this a positive development for a city? Is this the way to economically revitalize urban communities, to take this kind of approach? The second reason it's important is because many cities around the world, including other neighborhoods in New York, have looked to the High Line and attempted to cut and paste the project into their own space. And mostly this has not worked. Mostly this has either collapsed, so the projects have not been completed, or if completed, has had nothing like the gentrifying, revitalizing, exciting, iconic transformation that people hope for. And so one of the questions we ask in the book are, what are the lessons we can learn from the High Line? Why is it not transferable? And is that a good thing, that we can't just cut and paste the High Line? And I would suggest, of course, that's kind of a rhetorical question. Yes, it is a good thing, that revitalizing urban communities very often requires solutions that emerge out of the very specific geo-cultural specificities of that community. It's really hard to come in from above, from outside, and drop something into a community and say, this will fix whatever your neighborhood problems are.
And that, and you, in your account, the High Line does begin as a kind of grassroots operation, the renovation of the High Line. Is that the case? It starts, I mean...
Absolutely. So there's an organization called the Friends of the High Line, which really gets the whole project off the ground and moving. And they also maintain operational control over the park in a collaboration with the city's Department of Parks and Recreation. And very interestingly, this happened after our book went to press, so we were not able to incorporate it. But very interestingly, the co-founders of Friends of the High Line, in a recent piece that was published just a month or so back, actually reflected on how what began as a community grassroots initiative got transformed and hijacked into something very different. And if they could go back, they would approach this differently. So I think even the people involved in creating the High Line are now at a phase where they're reflecting not just on the success, but also potentially the failures of that project.
Interesting. Well, I'm going to shift gears now on you.
Okay.
So today I opened my email and I received a message from the provost of the university announcing the renaming of the School of Architecture and Allied Arts, where you are the dean. As of July 1st, you will be the dean of the College of Design. Tell us why that name change came about and why it makes sense. How did it happen and why is it a good thing?
Yeah. So I think it's important to emphasize that we're not just changing our name, but we're also changing the way we work within the college. So there's two parts to this. One is trying to rearticulate our academic intellectual identity as a community of scholars. And so that was a very interesting internal exercise. We had many, many conversations, workshops, debates, discussions about who we are as an academic community, and maybe more importantly, who we want to be as an academic community. And in the process of that, looking for where do we have overlap, where do we connect, but also where are we different from each other. And so AAA, as we're now known, Architecture and Allied Arts, I always like to describe it as a highly eclectic, intellectually cosmopolitan community. We have 10 different departments and programs. And we are academic, we are professional, we are creative. But right now, we also work in a highly siloed way. A lot of times in parallel, you know, alongside each other in parallel. So part of the College of Design idea is to think about what do we have in common. And design, we can't reduce ourselves to one word does not capture who we are. But it's the closest we could come to gesturing or evoking key aspects of what we all do within this unit. And so for us, design, we mean it in a broad, inclusive, flexible kind of way, as creative problem solving, or even creative problematizing. Because as scholars and artists, that's a big part of what we do. We problematize. So that's what the name is about. But what the name also allows us to do, and what this new College of Design as a structure will allow us to do, is to actually reorganize the way that we work with each other inside the college. So what we're proposing and what will happen starting this summer is we're creating interdisciplinary collaborative schools within the college that bring together clusterings of disciplines and programs that have strong connections to each other, intellectually, artistically, creatively. So there'll be the School of Architecture and Environment, which is landscape, architecture, interior architecture, historic preservation. There'll be a School of Art and Design, which brings together the Department of Art and the Department of Product Design. There'll be a School of Planning, Public Policy, and Management, which brings together urban, community, regional planning, public policy, nonprofit management, as well as arts and administration. And there'll be an independent department of the history of art and architecture. And that's the one part of our new structure that sticks out as a little bit odd. And a few people have reached out and said, my goodness, what are you doing to art history? You're marginalizing him. You're leaving him outside the school structure. But actually, both the names of the schools and the compositions of the schools came from our faculty. And this is what our art historians wanted, to be an independent department that connected to all the different parts of our new college, but also has some very strong connections outside the college to areas like the humanities here on campus. And so we wanted to make it possible for them to connect in that way.
So each of these colleges, I'm sorry, each of these schools within the college, they have a head, a director, each of these schools?
We're calling it a head, a head of school. And the idea is the head of each school will provide intellectual but also strategic and planning leadership for the departments and programs that are grouped within the school. And this is a new role that we're creating. It doesn't exist in our you know, organizational structure here at the University of Oregon yet. And I think a key part of these new roles is that the head of school will also be the person who needs to create the collaborative interdisciplinary conversations that are going to make the schools succeed. And what we're hoping is that we have a very, very unique combination of disciplines in the new College of Design. So there's nowhere else that I know of that has the same combination of disciplines. So what can we do differently and better than others because of who we have, the expertise and talent we have here? And so the head of schools, a big part of their job will be figuring that out and supporting newness, innovation, experimentation.
Do you have a sense of what some of the new, I mean, when you think 5 years down the line, are there certain innovations or accomplishments that you're dreaming of making happen in that time?
Well, I think that's a great question because that sort of future, that orientation towards the future, is very much how we frame the conversations that have been taking place this year. But we went a little bit further, actually. We were asking people, don't think about where we're going to be in 5 years. Where do we want to be in 50 years or beyond? You know, beyond our careers, beyond our lifetimes. What do we need to do now to set ourselves on a path to achieving what we want to be as a discipline, as a school, 50 years down the road? And of course, none of us knows what that's going to look like. But what was kind of liberating about that is that it allowed us to kind of shed all the very practical concerns that I think often constrain our thinking and planning right now, such as, do we have enough money to do what we want to do? Do we have enough buildings to house what we want to do? Do we, are we able to hire the professors and recruit the students that we need in order to do what we want to do? But we wanted the vision to drive the rest and not the other way around. And so, for us, one of the ambitions of the College of Design is to be the home of creativity on the university campus, not the exclusive home, because we can't claim to own creativity. I mean, universities everywhere, on all across campuses, are very creative environments. But we want to be a place where creativity is very central to our identity, something that we practice but also reflect on critically and rigorously. And we want to connect that with an ambition not just to work at the cutting edge of our disciplines, but really to be forming that cutting edge. So if we ask the question, where is art going? Where is architecture going? Where is landscape going over the coming decades? We want to be very involved nationally, internationally, in producing that leading edge. And to do that, we need to work differently than we currently are, because we have much more strength and expertise when we cut across disciplines. We'll always need the deep disciplinary expertise that comes with being an expert. But our strength here at the University of Oregon, like many other places, lies in what happens when we combine and cross disciplines.
We just have a couple of minutes left. This will be my last question. We've talked about many things, but one of the pending exciting initiatives that's coming is in September in Portland, you are hosting the City Futures and Urban Imaginaries International Workshop. Tell us about that.
So that is a an academic conference, a small academic conference, that is connected to the book project that I mentioned earlier on, which brings together scholars from across the humanities, social sciences, and design fields to address the question of what is the urban imaginary and how is it useful as a concept, productive as a concept in your research and writing. And as you know, a lot of times collaborative book projects tend to be very impersonal and distant. We as scholars are spread out all over the place and we communicate a little bit by email, we send in our work, things get printed and it's done. So the approach that I'm taking with my co-editor, who's based in the UK in the University of Lancaster in sociology, is to say we want to humanize this. So if we have authors getting together to write on a topic, we want them to actually get together. So that's the idea of that workshop, is to bring our authors together from their different locations in the US and elsewhere. And then I think for me, very importantly, to put that group into dialogue with our academic community here at the University of Oregon. Mm-hmm. So we will be inviting graduate students, faculty, as well as anyone who might want to wander in from the street. So this is a public event, it's free, it's open, and if you want to come along, you are welcome. Because I think for us as a group, we are going to be on board, I think, more or less with each other's thinking and being challenged with outside perspectives, different perspectives, unexpected perspectives. That's going to be very healthy. So a big part of this workshop will be bringing in the voices and the perspectives that can challenge and question what we're taking for granted. And I think that will make a stronger book.
Well, Christoph, thank you so much for this conversation, for telling us about that project and many others. Best of luck with the College of Design. I hope your vision can be realized.
Thank you, Paul.
Okay. I've been speaking with Christoph Lindner, professor and dean of the UO School of Architecture and Allied Arts, soon to be known as the UO College of Design. Thanks so much for watching.